Now, joining me on the line is our first guest of the day on this day, Friday the 16th of October. It's Larry from the Alienated Children First organisation. And Larry, first of all, I want to welcome you to the show. Good morning.
Thank you very much, Angela. I wish I was on the wild Atlantic way, I tell you that.
You don't know what you're missing. There's a lovely sunshine out there as well as
we
speak.
I was there a couple of weeks ago. It was only divine. Now, we got that beautiful week there at the end of last month, so I was thrilled.
I know, and we've to go on to more sombre subjects, unfortunately. But interestingly, the idea of the term alienation, a lot of people won't be familiar with it. But if I may just say a little bit about that before we have our chat. I mean, for a lot of people, they may not realise that psychological manipulation of a child against a parent can be very commonplace throughout this country, particularly in the context of separations, etc. Would you call parental alienation a type of abuse?
Oh, absolutely, it is abuse. it's actually technically illegal, although it's not recognised as that yet, because it qualifies as a form of coercive control, and coercive control is now illegal in Ireland. What it basically involves is the convincing of children by a mother or a father that their other parent is an evil person in circumstances where that is completely unwarranted. Now, there are cases where, you know, marriages break up because one or other party is deservedly unfit to parent the children. Yeah. But we're talking about cases where, you know, two loving parents separate for whatever unfortunate reason, and one of the parents decides, well, I'm going to punish the other child, the other parent, by making sure they never get to see their children. And yeah, the pain for the parent is, of course, palpable, as you can imagine, and it leads to something like 10% of the suicides in Ireland are directly related to it. But unfortunately, it's a multi-generational pandemic, for want of a better word, which really affects the children, and it is the children that we are advocating for in this regard, because they are the innocent parties, 100% innocent, who are the long-term victims of this, and they pass it on to their kids, and so it goes.
Well, I think it's, in a way, a very unrecognised issue because, of course, with the family law courts that we have in this country, you have what they call the in-camera rule, which means that things are held in private, which can be a very positive thing when it comes to sensitive issues. But as a direct consequence of that, quite a lot of the personal stories of an alienated parent don't really make it into the media. You mentioned the notion of the effect on the child, but also there must be a huge effect on the parent that is wrongly alienated.
Well, as I say, 10% of suicides in Ireland are a direct result. I think that gives you an indication as to just how much pain it causes. But it also creates, abject dysfunctionality in the alienated parent, because it's kind of like, if you can imagine, somebody comes along and kidnaps your children, and you know that they are being psychologically and emotionally abused, and you know where they are, and the courts and the guards tell you you're not to go near them, and you can't do anything about it. You cannot get up in the morning and say, oh, well, I'll just go off to work now, and I'll go and get a new job, or I'll go and enjoy a nice... You just can't function in life if your children are hostages. And that is a very sad reality of the more severe parental alienation cases that I've encountered in my time.
And I suppose as well, when it comes to a separated couple, at the end of the day, their relationship as a couple has effectively ceased, but their relationship as a parent has not. And the difficulty of assuming that they can cut all ties and at the end of the day not function as parents is a mistaken notion, really. I remember, not to be flippant about it, but I remember watching an episode of Dr. Phil, the American doctor who is sort of the celebrity style type of chat show, and he made the point that in every parental relationship, when it comes to separation, there is one of those parents that is a hero, and that hero is by definition the person who puts the child First. And I think that was very clever, because most, you know, in most cases of separation, there will be that need to kind of, I suppose, feel negative towards the person that you have separated from. But the real hero doesn't pass that negativity on to the child, because the child essentially has two parents that they want to love and spend time with.
And the children, of course, will love both parents and should love both parents and need to love both parents for their own mental health as they grow up. And it is quite true to say there is always one hero, and many times there are two heroes. But in the case of a situation where, you know, you are, your children are being told that you are a nasty person, and when you meet your children, they cower away from you. And when you go out in public, the neighbours are all whispering about you and looking at you and saying, look, that's your man there, yeah, and whatever. It's very difficult to then speak highly of the person that's doing that to your children in front of them, but you must, for their good, you know.
I do.
So,
I
yes, I'd say I'd give them hero status for being able to do that, because it's counterintuitive and it's against human nature. But, you know, kids come first. That's the bottom line.
And that is the essential definition of the hero, not putting themselves first. It's a shame, isn't it, that children can be used as pawns of power and control between a couple?
It's very sad. And, you know, parents seem to be of the opinion, well, I know it's probably, you know, upsetting the child now, but I'll do the damage control later on.
Yeah.
Once I've put her back in her box, or once I've put him back in his box, you know, then I'll sort the kids out and they'll be grand. And, you know, kids are resilient, aren't they? But they're not. Kids are like sponges. And, you know, I don't know if you remember your summer holidays as a kid, but mine went on for about 5 years. Every day, every year, you know, because you're just taking in so much information and you remember it permanently. So those this notion of, sure, I'll be able to do the damage control later on, it's not possible. The damage is done, and the damage will be there forever. All you can do is somehow try and mitigate the damage, but you cannot make it go away or repair it. It's just not possible.
And also,
as I say, it's a multi-generational thing, so it gets passed on to...
Yeah.
Sorry, Angela.
No, I beg your pardon. I was just going to say to you, despite everything we've said, we both know that it's out there, and the parental alienation concept, in some ways, the idea of bringing it into some sort of legal recognition might create a situation, would you agree, where there could be consequences for the parent who does this upon a child, so to speak, at the expense of an innocent parent?
That's where it all has to start, you know. And in a lot of countries around the world where they really value the family, like Mexico and Italy, if you're found guilty of parental alienation, it's a 10-year jail sentence. Like, it's taken very, very seriously, because they know very well that you are, you know, abusing children in the most heinous possible way, and that those children, you know, will go on to be unable to have relationships. Typically about 17, the self-harming starts, and then the suicidal ideation, and then the drug abuse, and it's a systemic process which is absolutely predictable, unfortunately. And yes, you're right, if it's not legislated against, it's going to go unnoticed. And unfortunately, you know, as we did some years ago with the Catholic Church, you know, should we brush it under the carpet for now, or we'll move that priest down the country and maybe the problem will just go away. And, you know, the judiciary were the ones that people went to in those days, saying, I think my little Johnny's being interfered with by a priest. And they were told, oh, for God's sake, don't be ridiculous now, that's nonsense. Years later, we realised it wasn't nonsense and it was an absolute travesty. But the judiciary at the time didn't know any better, and they did the very best with the information available to them at the time.
Mm.
And in 20 years' time, they will make movies about parental alienation abuse and the damage that it is currently doing in Irish society. And the same mantra will be trotted out, well, sure, the judiciary did the best they could with the knowledge available to them at the time. And it is our responsibility as parents who love children, to make sure that they have the latest and most up-to-date research and information available to them. And to that end, in defence of the government and the judiciary, they have been looking into this. And in fact, as you probably know, the Oireachtas held a joint party forum which published the report on the review of family law in October last year. Item number 36 of their recommendation is that there is a need to recognise and legislate against parental alienation.
Yeah.
The current status of things is that the minister has, Minister McEntee, has put together a separate committee, which she calls an oversight committee, and their job is to take all of the recommendations of that report and decide which ones will we crack on with. So what we're very keen to do is ensure that recommendation number 36 is one of the ones that they do crack on with. And to that end, we have been asking the Councils of Ireland to support us by signing a motion which will go to the government. And thankfully, as of Wednesday this week, we have 24 out of the 30 councils in Ireland have signed a motion to the government asking that that should happen.
Very good. I'm afraid we'll have to leave it there, Larry. Can I just say, in case people listening think that we're overstating this, I remember a child of a friend saying to me that, you know, he'd been told that he was going to get a new daddy. And that, you know, the anger in children over time with that sort of commentary in separation situations, I think, you know, the concept of parental alienation is much bigger than we realise. And good to see progress and that people have the energy to push the subject. Thank you very much for your own time. Have a good day.
Appreciate talking to you, Angela.
You're welcome. Bye-bye.
Well, there you go. Somber subject for this hour of the morning. But having said that, it's a reality for a lot of splintered families out there that caught in the middle is the child or children. One arm in one camp, another arm in the other, and trying to stay in a way that allows them to survive psychologically. You know, living in two different worlds, not necessarily listening to positivity in both homes. And what a hardship for a child who is trying to grow up on top of everything else. Now, joining me on the line is our first guest of the day on this day.